Varanasi. Tell us something about you and something about Varanasi.
Sir, my name is Saurabh Pandey. I am originally from Banaras. And I have done all my schooling in Banaras. After that, I graduated from Pilani, Rajasthan, in BITS. And I worked in semiconductor industry for approximately two years.
Where?
In Bangalore, Cypress Semiconductors.
Okay.
And then I moved to Delhi for civil service preparation.
When did you move to Delhi?
2015, sir.
Achha. What have you been doing since then?
Sir, I have been preparing.
Achha.
I have not worked anywhere. And I have appeared for interviews twice before this. And this is my third interview.
How much you got in the previous interview?
Sir, 182.
What it?
Yes. And sir, about the Banaras, it's very culturally.
What developments are, you know, Banaras? Prime Minister comes from Banaras, you know,
yes.
That is his constituency.
Yes.
And I think he has not taken a lot of initiative.
Yes.
To develop Banaras. Tell us about that.
Sir, the first noticeable thing is that cleanliness has improved a lot, especially in and around Ghats and other tourist places, cultural places. And there are some other developments also, vis-a-vis waterways and river port has been developed. And infrastructural projects are there, integration command and control system related to traffic, etc. are being set up there. And a lot of work has gone into those.
See, if the panel were to ask you that you are doing this after 2000, you know, Pilani is an institute of repute.
Yes.
And you seem to be a bright student. So they will say that why do you leave that job for the sake of civil service and you have lost 5 years in this, in the sense, because there is no certainty of its making.
Yes, definitely.
So on the hindsight, if they were to ask you, don't you think you should have? Because you have been working there for 7 years now.
Yes.
The point is, you know, if you look at the two sides of the coin, is it worth this?
Sir, of course, I have considered this thought that I might have done well in that, but because at that point of time I had both the options in front of me and I thought that this is somewhere I will be able to contribute better and I'm more inclined towards these issues which civil servants face. And the kind of challenges they have to overcome and they have to work with.
So what are the major challenges? Give me 2-3 major challenges which civil servants are facing today.
So major challenges are that, of course, we know the problems, but because resources are limited.
Tell me the challenges. What are the major challenges civil servants are facing? Major tasks.
So developmental tasks are there, social. The kind of social schemes which have to be implemented, often because of resource management, is the big task because there are different sectors which require development, and we civil servants have to manage. And
what about industrialization, job creation?
Yes, job creation is also a crucial thing. And how?
What role a bureaucrat can play in job creation?
Sir, primary role for bureaucracy would be how to create such systems. So that at least their sector, wherever they are posted, or districts or sectors, that creates easy paths for creation of jobs, industries, and for example, manufacturing, exports, etc., or cultural tourism, whatever economic activities have to happen in that sector. There are less roadblocks, right, and more ease of doing all those things.
Do you think law and order has also become one of the important issues at present?
Yes. It is actually the spine for development. Without law and order, a lot of
investment. So what do you think, you know, if you are managing a district, you know, like we are witnessing, you know, protest, demonstration, you know, in many parts of India. Suppose you are in UP, you know that. So the UP government has said that if some people have been protesting a CA and they have done some harm to the property, then some harm, then their property should be even confiscated. How will you, suppose you forget what government has said. So, first of all, should this protest continue? And if yes, then what should be done to manage them?
Sir, I don't think the protest should continue in this form. There are, of course, there's freedom to protest, there's freedom to voice dissent, but there are designated channels for that in a constitutional setup.
Like what? Designated channels like what?
For example, sir, even if they have to launch a mock public protest and demonstration, sites for that like Jantar Mantar, etc. Even in UP, people have taken to...
But say, small cities, are there designated places everywhere?
No, sir.
So, in a small town, if people want to, you know, express their feeling, so they will go out.
Yes.
So, if you are the district magistrate, then what will be your role, you know?
So, my role would be, if it is a peaceful protest, it should not inconvenience the other citizens who are participating in the day-to-day activity. So, the transport arteries should not be blocked. Any public conveyance system should not be blocked. Anything.
Would you like to? So, will your role will be trying to stop this demonstration, or trying to facilitate it, or trying to manage it? What will be your role?
Sir, manage it would be the closest term which I would prefer, because it's not constitutional to oppose them or support them, because it's not the prerogative of the law and order system.
What about imposing 144?
So, if it is critical, then this government has imposed it. Then it has to be implemented in that spirit.
You did your B in 2013, and 2 years you worked.
Yes.
And after 2015, what all have you done?
So work-wise, I have not done anything except I've been preparing. I have reached to.
So financially, how you supported yourself?
So for
with the savings of 30 years work.
For 2-3 years, yes, but later on I took support.
Why are you so keen? You are electronic engineer, you would have got a placement also.
I was placed.
You got placement. Yes. Then why you left and why you want to become a civil servant?
Sir, I think I had all my options in front of me. I had considered MS, I had considered MBA, etc. And I also got in touch with a lot of work which civil servants were doing. A few civil servants visited our campus also as part of what kind of career we can pursue. So we had interaction with the then district collector of Jhunjhunu district, Pilani. She also talked about the kind of work she has done. So, and other case studies of some civil servants.
Okay. Why you want to join civil
servants? Sir, I thought that the kind of challenges I would want to... all the paths which I had, none of them were easy and all of them were very rewarding themselves. But I felt more sensitive towards the challenges the civil service are facing or they are achieving. And that kind of inspired me, especially like a few of them case studies which I had.
Sardar Patel said once that bureaucrats are the steel frame of India.
Yes.
And then somebody made a statement that the steel frame is cracking.
Yes.
Tell me your reaction to the statement. Steel frame of bureaucrats is cracking.
Sir, I think bureaucracy...
Because you want to join, yes, bureaucracy. Yes. Still, I am not very clear why you want to join.
Sir, I think bureaucracy is steel frame. That is also correct. But like any other sector, there are problems in this sector also. And because... despite all these problems, India has progressed to whatever extent, or maybe not the kind of desired levels we want, but it has progressed. So some people are definitely doing their job well, and the kind
do
of
things. It is true that steel frame is great.
Sir, yes, there are a lot of problems with bureaucracy also, and often, based on my understanding, a lot of bureaucrats themselves are victim of those problems, and they are not able to do work. They find challenges and limitations and constraints in the system.
So how will you take a political interference in your work? So you will weigh ethics more than the politics?
So not politics per se, but because political parties are representatives of the people, the kind of mandate they have, I will have to respect that. And following, I will have to reconcile that with the law and order and whatever the standard operating procedures. Like in police administration, whatever standard operating.
Who is your role model in bureaucracy?
Sir, there are quite a few. Not
name one.
Armstrong Payne was in the beginning when I read about Armstrong Payne. He was a young bureaucrat in Manipur. He constructed a road in the village, and the kind of with the kind of focus and crowdfunding etc. he used, I found it very innovative.
The contribution of UP in India's independence movement.
Sir, the whole Lahore to Bengal belt was actually sent. A lot of activities happened in the current Uttar Pradesh region. From the Kakabi robbery to Bhagat Singh and others also had a lot of activities going in this region.
Just
put
it quiet. Don't explain to that.
Okay, sir.
Role of UP in India's independence.
Sir, UP was had the origin of 1857 Sepoy Mutiny also. It has revolutionary activities as well, and Congress sessions etc. were also very active in this region. So
okay.
All
okay.
These.
Fine. I insist on this. If you were to talk before representatives of United Nations to defend India's case of getting permanent seat in UN Security Council, how will you defend India's case? Very quickly, in 1 minute, we are the UN members sitting there and you are representing India's case for getting permanent seat and Security Council.
Sir,
one minute.
Sir, I would say that since the origin of the United Nations, in the past 70 decades or so, a lot of global realities have changed and India has progressed a lot from what it was in 1945. And because as far as global South is concerned, India is the largest democracy, and the kind of Western values which India has now owned up itself, that kind of values are required in Global South, because a lot of future challenges and future development paths have to be implemented in Global South, and India can be a leader in that. So without a united permanent seat at United Security Council, that kind of representation is not going to be there, and only Western narrative will not be able to bring the multilateral.
You are missing out on our strength. Nobody will accept. You are missing out on what India stands, where it stands today. How will you make India great?
Sir, economic development, share in global GDP will be high.
Okay.
Security, net security provided in the region and beyond. And the kind of cultural richness India has, and contributions in those fields. And contribution to future challenges like climate change, security, terrorism, etc.
Mention all that India is leading the world in so many things, then only UN will understand this. UP recently had a case of encounters.
Yes, sir.
And human rights immediately came and objected to the encounters by the case. Tell me, what is your view? Intervention of human rights, is it justified to say that encounters are not good? When are encounters justified? And why human rights should intervene?
Sir, blanket characterization either side is not possible. But given the scenario in UP, because the law and order situation is not at par with the other states or other developed states as we perceive it to be, so often a lot of criminals have a very very strong hold in their regions, and in fact security of police officials also matters. So sometimes face-to-face encounters become very violent, and encounter deaths have also happened. So it's not
face-to-face encounter is never officially. What is an encounter?
So encounter is like a criminals and police officials
Think about it. Last question I want to ask you is that UP introduced commissionerate system in 2 cities. What was the need for introducing commissionerate system?
Sir, in the 2 places where it has been introduced, Noida and Lucknow, because population has grown manifold and a lot of new urban challenges, law and order situations are probable. So, it was thought that some more efficient police administration is required, and maybe to curtail some delays and give more power to the police and take decisions.
I could see that
you have got an opportunity to teach primary level children,
yes.
Primary school
yes.
children. Okay. So, what do you learn?
Sir, I learned that given the opportunity, there is nobody, as in, I think almost everybody in India is very interested to learn. And it is often the case of not having that opportunity. And my even I am from Banaras, so the kind of schooling I got, I was very fortunate that I got. And many people in those regions do not have that, so I could relate to the problems they have.
So, since you have already got award at City Montessori School,
yes.
Montessori is a method of teaching. Do you know about it?
No.
Okay. CSR, you have worked in CSR.
Yes, sir.
What is it?
Sir, it stands for Corporate Social Responsibility, wherein the 2% profit share of the average profit of the last 3 years is supposed to be spent on social causes or developmental causes by corporates.
Mm-hmm.
It was which is part of the company at 2030. So my company has
so adopted. What role CSR can play in education, especially in primary?
Sir, I think one of the major roles they play is in education. So my company, where I work, they had adopted a school till class 10. So they funded some teaching, and for weekends we used to take weekend classes for different subjects, etc. So that kind of momentum was provided in and around.
So if you take weekend classes,
yes.
Okay, you are taking the weekend holidays of the students.
So not yes.
Sorry.
Only Saturdays we used to take, Friday, Saturday. So we actually included Friday, Saturday as weekend.
Okay. So at the teacher level, you teach without any background or everybody has to teach there?
Because it was primary level, so we taught basic maths, basic English, basic reading, some literature. Literature at very primary level, like poems or some stories.
But do you think that there is some sort of issues while teaching to the primary school children? You must have some characters or some skills to teach the primary school teachers. What are those skills?
Sir, so I'm not very trained in that skill, but I think there is a need to understand that they are kind of a blank slate. So we don't have to assume that they will perceive it the way we do. So from that starting point, that zero point, we have to actually kind of inquire that what they feel about these objects when we teach them about stuff.
So you see there is a deficit in primary school teacher.
Yes, sir, definitely.
Okay, and the skills they are not getting.
Yes.
So what should we do to provide them adequate training?
Sir, training is one thing which you require, and like
training
I do
about what?
Teacher training for primary schools?
Yes, teacher training. And teacher training, what should we teach to the student, to the teacher?
So first of all, teachers have to be very regular. Mm-hmm. That is not part, become is a part of skill as such, but the regularity is not there.
That is the challenge. So, tell me the skills they need.
Skills, I think skills, some skills to engage the students, to let them, make them think, rather than just giving them 2 pages to read and mug them up and reproduce.
Yes.
And a lot of, I think learning through activity can also be part of young students, because they don't have urgency in the exams at that level, like nursery level or LKG level. So, learning through activities, learning through skill-based, activity-based, group activities.
Can you tell me one case study where, by making this kind of intervention, you could change the person?
Sir, like in Pilani village, there was a primary school where we had conducted an event, not an event, an activity where we told them to make placards about the problem in climate. What is the role of trees, what is the role of lakes, etc. So they were first taught about all those things, and they came up with their own kind of arts to represent that. So that kind of intervention in that area had actually changed the way people thought about the in and around Pilani, because the students really took to that activity and learned about it and they enjoyed it. Okay. And so environmental education was not very interesting before that, but then got
okay. Okay, suppose you are posted as a secretary in a department of school or department of primary schools. Okay, what are the initiatives that you would take to, you know, improve the education standards in the country?
So I'll again say that teacher, I whatever whoever education expert should be involved in the kind of teacher skill training has to be there. Then regularity of teacher, absenteeism, etc. need to pick up. And then we have to see the kind of learning outcomes they have come up with. And not learning outcomes not only in based on percentages, but also in other things like reading skills, math skills, etc. And there should be different parameters instead of only marks.
Okay, I could see that you have been awarded awarded in National Cyber Olympics.
Yes.
So what are the cyber problems that we are facing?
So currently, because the cyber penetration has become so fast in India, and a lot of people are not very adept to it, or they are fastly catching up to it in a surprising manner, but they are not very aware of the threats it has, because suddenly with a lot of...
What are the threats?
So like banking frauds are there, data security, privacy issues have been there. If there are some like women, cyberbullying of women, leaking their photos, etc.
How will you ensure data security in the country?
So there are many ways. Encryption is one way, and also fake news to protect situations like fake news. The metadata needs not to be stripped off from the origin, wherever that information originates. And data localization is also being considered, and that is very crucial to sovereignty as well as security issues, so that it's not exploited by others.
What is data localization?
So data localization essentially is that the data of citizens of India...
Is it a threat?
Data localization is not a threat.
So another, you talked about another part of the threat.
No sir, I meant that when data is flowing outside, data localization can be considered. So that it is not creating economic issue or espionage issues or security issues and privacy issues for citizens.
Currently there is an issue between India and the US regarding data localization. So what are those issues?
Sir, India policy wise is for data localization, whereas multinational corporations do not support it, and they are not very excited about it, because they want to, because India has a lot of data, and the kind of data companies like Amazon, Facebook, etc. would like to use freely, and if data localization is there, they will not be able to use the data freely.
Okay, so they have already invested in the system.
Yes.
And they are getting the data.
Yes.
So what are the problems that we have because of the data?
But as such, there would be no problem, because Amazon has a subsidiary. Economy wise, it will help a lot of people. It has its own benefits. But often, because there are many actors involved internationally, and it's not only US, so whatever channels we create can be exploited by other entities which we do not want to use. For example, neighborhood is not very friendly to us. So to have that kind of a policy and law structure in place, probably we might have to consider restricting it for friendly
companies. Okay, if we prohibit other companies to use our data, do we have problems?
Yes, sir. Because data is actually valuable, and we data maybe it can be stored here, but it can be still misused by governments or other corporate entities. Also, we do not have our own companies to utilize that data. So.
So you mentioned that something about CSR you mentioned,
yes.
Right, and you said it is a provision in the Companies Act, and you mentioned 2013,
yes.
You said, right. So what do you want to say, before 2013 there was no social governance by the corporates, or what?
Sir, I'm not aware of any legal provisions, but this corporate social CSR probably was stipulated, this 2%. The kind of framework we have is from the...
In fact, companies were doing lots of things since beginning. But why do you think the government felt the need to legislate this? Well, this is my desire.
I'm a company, I want to give something to the society, give back to the society. This should be left to my will, but why then government decided and then they put this 2%?
Yes, sir, I think it's a valid argument that it should be voluntary, and so it's because it's social service and it helps the brand value of the corporates. Mm-hmm. So ultimately they might do it themselves.
So if I don't do, I don't spend this 2%.
Yes.
So am I liable for any punishment or whatever?
I think they legislated that, but they later removed the previous interim budget which came. It initially legislated.
So then what does it mean? If there is nothing the government want to do against me, why there is a provision?
Yes, sir. I think it's a valid argument that it can be done away with.
But it can be done away with? There's no need?
As in personal, my personal opinion is I have not gone through the whole policy, how the decision was taken.
But if there is no legislation, then some companies would not like to do it.
Yes.
Then what will happen?
So then government will fall short of resources. So probably that kind of balancing has been done and this decision.
So there should be legislation or not for CSR? Some amount is fixed. What do you say?
I don't see any problem with it, but in principle, I'm not totally against that. It acts as a tax itself, and it's a coercive measure. It's a semi-coercive measure at least. But because we have a lot of social issues and developmental issues, so they have government has managed resources and adjusted 2% in their own wisdom. This policy has been made. So
the government has initiated many missions. You know.
Yes.
So can you name a few?
Mission Indradhanush has been done for vaccination, and Namami Gange mission is for cleaning Ganga. Textile mission was in this the latest budget. Technical textile missions was introduced. For the past decade, the cotton and cotton mission, mustard.
There's mission Swachh Bharat also.
Yes.
Do you think it has been successful?
Yes, sir. So far, but of course it has a lot still to do, but yes, the kind of time it has taken to change a lot of things, it was noticeable and remarkable.
You mentioned you watch superhero movies.
Yes.
So who is your favorite superhero?
Sir, my favorite is Batman.
Batman? Yes. Why?
Because I read it as a child, and then I think that same generation grew up and they started making movies. So there are very remarkable movies which were made in the previous decade. Mm-hmm. So there was a three-part movie, and the kind of constraints has been depicted in that movie, and he's still trying to figure out. So there are a lot of gray areas, and it's not very black and white. So that tussle and that dilemma situation is good to see in that movie.
So your first posting, if you're selected.
Yes.
Yes. What are the first three things you would like to do in your district? And why?
So considering the kind of districts I have seen in my home state, first few things I would see that cleanliness and clean transport arteries, clear transport arteries is one thing. Probably some new ones which are pending, because a lot of transport project is there, but they are not finished on time. So in fact, instead of conveniencing, this start to inconvenience the people. And second would be power systems, like a lot of electricity infrastructure is like wired and overhanging in the streets, etc. So they hamper the tourism environment, and the kind of when people visit to cultural places, they inconvenience that. So power system can be made underground or things like that. And third would be law and order, because in Uttar Pradesh kind of city, there is a lot of certainty of not being punished. So that kind of perception would have to change. And
who has this perception, certainty of not being punished?
As in, I have seen in some areas where people know that, okay, helmet, if I don't wear helmet, nobody is going to do anything. Uh-huh. I can argue and get my way around it. Uh-huh. Or even in cases of some people can go and shoot also. It's very rare, but it should not happen in my opinion. That
what is the best way to ensure that people wear helmets?
Constant campaign awareness is one thing, and there should be penalty also. For example, in the last 2 years I have seen in Banaras district that they have installed cameras, and I have seen people stopping on the crossings. They wear helmets because digital charans are sent to them, and no police has to speak there.
So
they are not hiding from police anymore because they know it's going.
So that's it. If you put cameras at prominent places, that will solve the problem. Do you think so?
Not all problems, but of course, but at least that there is some semblance that, okay, now I'm not going to escape because of there is going to be a ticket, at least some inconvenience will happen, because if I don't wear helmet, so why not better wear a helmet and move? So the gradual perception management has to happen.
Thank you.
Okay, Saurabh. So geography was your optional subject.
Yes, sir.
Why geography?
So geography, for example, when I started the preparation, I heard that it has easily available materials, and in school I really liked geography. So I switched to
combination of both the factors.
Yes.
Okay, is there any city which has exactly a time gap of 12 hours from India?
12 hours from India?
Yeah. City or any country?
USA.
Okay, any other?
Canada has. Mexico.
Any other?
I think.
Is it exactly 12 hours?
No, it has 5 time zones, but yes, some parts have from 10 and a half hours to, I think, 12.
Okay, fair enough. Okay. Why is it called West Bengal when there is no East Bengal?
So because the origin of the state originates from partitions. The whole of Bengal, when it was partitioned, so East Pakistan, because it was the whole of Bengal, the East Bengal became East Pakistan and West Bengal was left. So
okay.
It was named there.
So seeing the trend of name changing of various states, so shouldn't it be renamed also?
So probably if it is that in high on somebody's priority, so I have no neither opposition nor any interest to change
okay.
the name.
What is the logic behind this?
Changing names?
Exactly.
So often people try to, when they think that a disruption has happened and they feel that it was unjust, so they try to change it. Like Bangalore, where I lived in Bangalore, and a lot of people didn't like Bangalore, and the name was changed. Bombay happened, in fact, Prayagraj, Allahabad to Prayagraj happened. So they tried to restore.
Okay. Why Kanyakumari is not a major port?
So because ports require harbor. So just the tip is usually not very helpful, and the indentations, etc., have to be there to
okay.
have some harbor.
Any other major reason, if you can think of?
I'm not aware. I visited there once, but I'm not sure. Maybe geography, siltation, etc., the kind of shelf it has. So I have not checked, but probably these are.
Okay, anyways. Have you heard of Cyclone Vardha?
Yes, sir, I have heard.
Okay, what are the ecological effects of the Cyclone Vardha?
Ecological effects is usually when cyclone hits it, it causes a lot of storm surge, etc. So, coastal marine ecosystems is definitely damaged. It has a lot of loss of life and property, that's economic and social cost.
Generic points, any other?
And
yeah.
Ecological impact of cyclones, if it damages the vegetation, etc., it will hamper the runoffs, it will hamper percolation for future water cycles, and it will disturb local ecological communities.
While filling your preferences, you have mentioned 99 number in few states.
Yes.
What does 99 stand for?
So, because it's zone-wise preference. So,
okay.
Once at one point, if we say that it's okay, the other ones are equal for me. So, if I stop at any point, the rest of them become 99.
Okay. So, why Nagaland, Manipur and Himachal Pradesh?
Yes.
To my surprise, you filled 99.
Sir, nothing against Himachal Pradesh or Nagaland, but I think it stopped somewhere ahead Himachal Pradesh. So Himachal Pradesh was in another zone, and I'm not very aware of any northeastern states. Although I would not mind going there, but I cannot give foolhardy that okay, no, I'll fill it at first.
Okay, my last question: why fertility rate in Uttar Pradesh is higher as compared to other northern states?
In Uttar Pradesh, it's very much related to socio-economic setup in Uttar Pradesh, and because it has low urbanization, women have less bargaining power, etc., and health infrastructure is weak. So when people think that okay, our children are not going to be healthy, they tend to have more children, and historically also we have seen that it's an agrarian region, so people require more manpower to have their own family setup, etc., economic activities.
Okay, so. Okay, you can wait outside for